Today, and very good afternoon to all of you. We have with us Dr. B.P. Mathur, who has been a former officer from the cadre called Indian Accounts and Auditing Services. I know him at least for 13, 14 years now. My relationship with him started somewhere around 2004, when on one fine morning, the newspaper Hindu had this story by J. Venkateshan that told us that there was a committee that was appointed by Department of Public Enterprises. This committee was entrusted with the task of looking at what amendments needs to be done in Companies Act, and in their own wisdom or lack of a wisdom, the committee that was headed by someone who came from a corporate background was trying to make this argument that in post-1991, in post-liberalization era, CAG should not be auditing PSUs anymore. Dr. Mathur was a voice from the service who argued that CAG audit is not a duplication audit of PSUs. It's an audit that looks into PSUs' governance, and it's not merely checking of balance sheet. And I was just a new entrant who was trying to articulate my thoughts based on my reading of CAG audit reports. I started reading audit reports from 2002 onwards in my own ways. And I had, by 2004, engaged with few of the commercial audit reports. The very significant being the one that was for Gujarat Commercial for the year ending March 31st, 2001, that had told the nation the story about how the controversial Narmada Dam and its builder Sardar Narmada Nigam Limited went about taping the capital market indiscriminately, and what sort of unsustainable debt liability it created for us all. So in 2004, my interaction with Dr. Mathur would have started as emails, and he wrote a piece in the prominent newspaper. Sucheta Dalal wrote a piece, and I was writing for a small not-for-profit portal. That's also something that gets published from Bangalore, called indiatogether.org. And I did two articles on this. Interaction with very senior people like Dr. Mathur or K.P. Joseph started without knowing them by face, without ever meeting them, merely by this virtue that we were all writing about an issue that touches our code with what our constitutional institutions are and what is the state in which they are functioning today. So in 2007, December, I remember picking up a phone and calling him up. The then CAG, his tenure was coming to an end. Era Salian and others had started writing about the process by which the nation state chooses the next incumbent for the position of CAG of India. And we had quite a good interaction. In 2007, his book that looks at governance, accountability, and public audit, published by Uppal, was getting released, and that's when I met him first. Other interactions were over email, without ever seeing his face or meeting him personally. From 2007 onwards, we have exchanged our views often on emails, and we have met. I was there in Delhi, and by chance, his new book, which also talks very different subject about the way we look at the notion of development. And he titles this book as An Alternative Philosophy of Development. And we here have amongst our audience students who are doing postgraduate degree in development, which we don't call development studies, neither do we call it development action. We try to combine thinkers and practitioners, and that's the philosophy that our university tries to espouse. The university started functioning in 2011. This is the fifth batch of students who will take MA development degree this year. And I hope among students, there are students who are doing MA in public policy and governance who would find this talk today where Dr. Mathur is talking to us about public service reforms with keeping in mind the good governance part of it and what needs to be done in terms of India's public services and reforming it. How does someone like Dr. Mathur looks at bureaucracy, and what is the contribution that comes from bureaucrats who are implementers and executors of policy decisions when it comes to issues ranging from welfare services to public service delivery to the governance. I would call upon Dr. Mathur to come here and speak to you. And then he speaks for about 45, 50 minutes, and then we will take question and answer. His publisher, Routledge Books, from which he has published two books. The earlier book is out of print, I'm told, but is a good book for public policy and governance students, because Dr. Mathur in that book talks about the ethics in governance. That book came out a couple of years back, and this new book has not yet reached Bangalore, the South sales offices, so they have not been able to bring the book. But there is a flyer of the book, and if you give your address and if you would like to purchase the book, the publisher would give you a pre-order discount. Over to you, Dr. Mathur.
Good morning to you. Professor Upadhyay, my colleague Mr. Sethu Madhavan, who has been Deputy Auditor General and an IMF advisor, distinguished faculty of this university, and students. I feel greatly honored to be invited to give this talk and to talk to the young students who are here. Now, I belong to a service and to the Auditors General's organization, but we work mostly in the finance ministry and elsewhere, like my colleague. And he, we were discussing what is the topic I should give a talk, and he said, suggested that I speak on this development issue, which is my latest book, which was released last month by Delhi by Dr. Murali Manohar Joshi. So I said I can speak, as he just mentioned, on this topic, but I thought there is another important aspect on governance, which is on which I have written a book, as he said, Ethics in Governance. And I thought I'll speak on this topic. Now, when I studied in Allahabad University economics, I was told the problem of a development, of course this was some 5 decades back in 50s and 60s, I was told the problem is capital. Once you get capital, you know, country will develop. You see, 4 factors of production and you get capital, everything will be hunky-dory. But working 4 decades in public services, from Assam to Punjab to Maharashtra, I thought the real problem is governance, and problem is public services. Why India is facing this problem? And then I was director of National Institute of Financial Management for 4 years, where we trained boys who are recruited through the IAS examination into the class one service, railways, defense, who are allocated to finance. So after that, I thought, what's the problem after meeting these boys? So I wrote one book, Governance Reform for Vision India, I studied. And at that time, Dr. Kalam was president. So I got an opportunity to present this book to him. He was flipping this book, just like that, when I went to meet him. And I had one chapter, India Towards Zero Corruption. So Dr. Kalam asked me, Is it possible for India towards zero corruption? I had no answer. I told him, sir, you are asking me this question, but this question kept bothering me. And then I took up this job and I found that our problem basically is ethics and values. It's country's problem. I wrote one book, Ethics and Governance, about which was published in 2014 by Routledge. And I am going to share some of my thoughts about governance. Now you see that governance, of course, means executive, judiciary, legislature. But basically where it is interface with people is with the executive, what you call public service, public services. Now you see Yogi Adityanath has taken over as Chief Minister of UP. Last evening I was just watching TV here, and there was a TV clipet in some minister for state for education visiting some school in a village, Unnao district next to Lucknow. And then she was carrying a small baby in her lap, and she was with the baby, she was nursing the baby rather than teaching the children. Other day, every day, some of the UP ministers are, these days with the new government, going to the medical, to the hospitals and find doctors are missing. So this kind of sporadic thing is coming, whenever new is coming. But again, nobody looks into what is the fundamental problem of public services, why don't they deliver? Some kind of gimmickry comes, new government comes, something else, they again settle to the same old ways. Everybody has been talking, what is the problem? So, of course, politics is important, political executive, political leadership, but what is the problem of governance? So, what I find is there are structural problems in our public services. And that's what, and they don't teach you in the business school. I have been talking, once I went to IIT Delhi in the Department of Business, I said, you are only talking of the corporate sector. All business schools, whether I am Calcutta or I am Bangalore, they teach you only corporate. They don't teach about the internal structure of public service and what reform is needed. So you don't talk it in the university. See, today also we are not, government is also the biggest employer, because after all, whatever is organized employment in our country, which is about 3 crore out of a population of only about 90% people are only in formal sector in our country. And people who are in formal sector, out of that 70 to 80% are in government or government supported institutions like universities. They're also funded by government. They have the same culture. So what are the structural problems? That's what I thought. I will discuss the problem. What is in the government? And then I will, come out with what other countries have done. So I'll try to cover in 45, 50 minutes so that we have some time left. Now, how do I move? Yeah, from here, okay. So I said quality of governance is behind the success stories of rich societies. So India's poverty is not due to lack of resources or money or enterprise on the people. The problem is good governance. People say India is a poor country. I say India is not a poor country. It's a rich country where poor people live. Because we have the best resources, we have the Himalayas, we have the best resources, we have the best soil type. We have the water, we have minerals, everything. But we cannot optimize. Indians, when they go abroad, do very well. They are very entrepreneurial. So we are a first-rate people trapped into a third-rate system. Now government is simply not designed to work. That's what I'm going to tell you. The way government works, it's simply not designed to work. So government machinery is completely broke. And this is what, when Bill Clinton was president, they appointed a very high level committee, a government which works better. And this is what, which was headed by Al Gore, vice president, this is what they said. Our leaders spend most of the time debating policy issues. But if the vehicle is designed to carry policies broken, new policies won't take us anywhere. If the car won't run, it hardly matters where we point it. We won't reach anywhere. And if you look at governments, you know, if you go into any management school, personnel management, financial management, operational management, these are the three disciplines. Like government, look at the government's personnel management, their budget management, and their operational management, largely contracting system, and a few things how government works. Now, one is, in government, there is no incentive for good work and disincentive for poor performance. Government mein ghode gadhe sab barabar, if I can put it. You see, so there is tremendous job security in government. Now, as they say it, government workers are like headless nail. You can get them in, but you can't get them out. Government servants are like headless nail. I'm not quoting. This is the US Performance Review Commission's quote. They face this problem, but they are doing something to reform it. Government servants are like headless nail. There is a huge amount of protection built into the government's system. And Article 311 of the Indian Constitution guarantees this. In fact, nowhere in the world there is a constitutional guarantee to government. There is only a contract arrangement. And the commission to review the constitution, headed by Justice Venkatachaliya, former Chief Justice of India, had recommended its change. Second, ARC, has Administrative Reforms Commission, has also recommended that too much security creates a problem for government servant. Then government, what is happens? Promotion policy and career advancement is mostly by years of seniority you get promotions. By years of seniority, which you are getting your promotion. So mediocre people, once you join the civil service, you manage to get recruited into the Indian Administrative Service or Indian Audit Account Service or any of these service, graded promotion, hardly ever few people are bypassed or removed. That is another one. Then even if you want to punish somebody, disciplinary proceedings, which is, there is a disciplinary code there, Civil Services Classification Control and Appeal Rule, that cushions of safety are built. Multiple channel. So there are cases, even doctors from Maharashtra, go on a deputation to Dubai on permission for 1 year. Then they stay there for 2 years, 5 years. And they are absent from duty. They come back and join back. And rules are such that it's so difficult to punish them. People disappear from their jobs. So the whole system is so designed. So what I say, there is, you talk of accountability. What is accountability? There's no accountability in government. Accountability is built. One is institutional accountability. That is one thing. Like CAG is an institutional accountability machinery for executive. But here, individual accounting, unless you build in the system, how will you get performance? In government, there is no accountability system. So this is a general our philosophy in the country. Rights only. Rights, rights, rights. No duty. Mahatma Gandhi had said, now of course we have every right, women have a right, child has a right, everybody has a right in this country, but no duty. Mahatma Gandhi said, your rights come from your duty. So we have created in the entire country reservation rights, this right, that right, although your duty has been incorporated by amending in the Constitution. Some of you are aware that there is a duty portion in the Constitution. Most of the people are not even aware that there is a duty provision in the Indian Constitution. Everybody knows about his rights. So in the country, we have created a psychology of rights only. No psychology of duty. So that's one problem. Now, our problem is with laws and rules. There are so many rules and laws written, which were written mostly in the colonial time. We have not updated them. We have not written. So in government itself, you see the government, hundreds of rules are there for staff car. There's this big thing, how to use a staff car in government. For medical rules, this much thick. Then fundamental rules, delegation of power rules, hundreds of rules. So internal government machinery itself gets jammed. That is one thing. Secondly, when you have interaction with public, recently in 99, government appointed a commission to review the obsolete laws. And it found that there are 2,500 obsolete laws in the country, of which 1,300 have become obsolete. They could not compile, get the data for state government laws, which they estimated to 25 to 30,000 laws in the state government. Nobody has knowledge. There used to be a very famous case, if you remember some few years back, Wadhwa case, where Bihar government used to issue an ordinance. And ordinance after 6 months used to lapse, and they forgot to get its continuation. So ordinance was there, they were still practicing when it had lapsed. It was a big case at that time, some 20 years back. Now, NDA government, when Bajpayee was prime minister, deleted some 400. Now this present government also has deleted. Some of those were made on the budget laws, it says they had irrelevant. Now Vivek Debroy, you have heard his name? Famous economist, member of the Planning Commission, he has written a book, Absurdities of Law. Now, one interesting case, which he cites, the Sarai Act of 1867. Sarai, you understand? Sarai means a guest house. So in that Sarai Act of 1867, there is a provision, any passerby, 1867, who is going, it is mandated to give him water, piyau. So there is a 5-star hotel in Delhi. I know the Meridian Hotel. They were having trouble with the municipal corporation. Staff wanted some bribe. So you used the Sarai Act of 1867 to issue a notice and punish them that you are not serving water by who are going by in front of that road. That's how these laws act. So all these are necessary. There is a what is known as Essential Commodities Act. 13 ministries of Government of India administer it. And they have issued 150 orders under this, just to illustrate. Each in conflict with each other. Nobody seems to have reviewed these things. So this is how problem. So that is one part. Now government has a sprawling bureaucracy chock full of babus. See, we have a hierarchical structure. If I tell you how a class one officer starts, which my sir, if you are a class one officer, an IAS officer, or Indian Revenue, you go to secretariat, under secretary, deputy secretary, above him is a director, a joint secretary, an additional secretary, a special secretary, and a secretary to government. This is class one officer. So files travel multiple channels, so no decision gets taken. Although there are recommendations, the file should not travel more than two. Then at the Babu level, you have LDC, UDC, assistant, section officer, desk officer, so many channels. Not only this, you see, there are total, central government, there are 35 lakhs employees. 35 lakhs employees, central government. Now, class one officers, which include IAS officers, IPS officers, revenue officers, engineers, doctors are only 70,000. 2%. And even if he wants to be very effective, he cannot against the sprawling bureaucracy, because class one officers get transferred here, there. Those fellows are sitting in secretariat here all their life. And they develop huge vested interest into the system. So your writ cannot run. We all faced it. We all faced it. You see, in law, they have their own method of doing the work. For example, in Accountant General office in Assam, when I got posted after 6 years of service, there were only 5 or 6 class officers, and there were 2,000 these officers who at that time pay salary provident fund used to be issued from Accountant General. He is not going to listen to you. How many people? They develop their own style. So chock full of babis. Secondly, the there is a huge wage burden of public employees across the board. Now, 10 years, government appoints a pay commission giving salary increases to them. And they are getting salary increases without any linking with their productivity. And over few years past, such steep increases in salaries have been given. And I had just computed as percentage of government revenue, you cannot even get it. So earlier, only 35 lakhs government employees, 15 lakhs defense, army, navy, plus pension. There are about 50 lakhs pensioners, huge number. Their salary bill, if you compute, was 15% of central government revenue in 2007-8. I've given these figures in my book, in the recent book. When the pay commission came, it jumped to class in 2008-9 to 25% of government revenue. Now, the latest pay commission which has come, I don't know whether Karnataka, every state implements its own, following the central government pay, right? It has come only last year. It has jumped to 30%. So 30% of government revenue in government proper. Some problem? Achha. Huh, that is better. Yeah, that will become easy. So such increase. Now government gets periodical increases of dearness allowance every 6 months. It covers, it's completely neutral. So this is according to my computation 30, but this does not include autonomous bodies. Autonomous bodies like All India Institute of Medical Sciences or Lalit Kala Academy, they are all getting funded by government. They are not. If you add to their plus other products like staff, car, guest house charges, you will discover that 50% of entire government revenue goes only to pay salary to their own employees. So perks, that's all about government. And nobody is making noise about it. Now, till the other day, before now this has been merged, 120% of salary was dearness allowance. So government has now worse and again raised the salary. Now then, the biggest problem that we face is the IAS domination everywhere. Today, you are chairman of a electricity board, you see, and then you are working in secretariat, there is no specialization and that dominates all other. You may be director of education, sometimes you get IAS officers get appointed as vice chancellor of a university. Now there is no system of, say, specialization in government. So this is a big problem, and repeated commissions, administrative reforms commission have said that this system must change. Several first administration commission, second commission, even commissions appointed by very competent IAS officers who have included, they are all saying we must specialize. Today is a day of specialization. For example, somebody working in the Department of Economic Affairs in Government of India, my friend has been with the IMF. You see, you have so much, you don't have any knowledge of international finance. It deals with your exchange value of rupee, even demonetization, its implications, things like that. So there is no specialization in the government, and this is despite, so this is what one very distinguished professor has said of public administration about an amateur, why doesn't reform doesn't come? An amateur civil service has enjoyed a hegemonic role in administration, and since any measure of administrative modernization is bound to upset this equation, its opposition to any worthwhile recommendation is intense and resolute. Where administrative reform is concerned, the generalist civil service, that means the IAS in India, acts as a third chamber of national legislature, where it functions as an opposition party commanding a permanent majority, vetoing, amending and shelving reform proposals as it pleases. So no reform comes. And then my experience was Peter's Bureau, an incompetent in high office. If you have an incompetent boss anywhere, including a university, see, incompetent in high office is like a man on a mountain top. Everything looks small to him and he looks small to everyone else. Where I have worked with very incompetent boss, he finds all his subordinates as He's incompetent. But everybody in his office says that he's a duffer. But this is because he has so much glorification about his, so much ego about his own importance. So this is how it happens. Okay. And government is highly centralized. You see, the Prime Minister, there is something known, just to give a how centralized the Government of India working is, what is known as Appointments Committee of the Cabinet. Every senior appointed committee is appointed by this committee, which is headed by the Prime Minister, the Home Minister, and one minister who is dealing with this subject. So even Joint Secretary's appointment in Government of India, Commissioner of Income Tax, you see, all these go to this committee. Hundreds of PSU directors, now they have no time. That's why you find the PSU posts are vacant for months together. There's no delegation. This is no delegation in Government of India. Or even, for example, the Vice Chancellor of a central university, appointment goes to the PM. In fact, it is going to the President. Right now, I was the other day on finance committee of one new central university in Ranchi. And they couldn't get appoint the first finance officer because it needed an approval with the President. First, it has to come to the recommendation from all the bureaucratic channel, what appointed by education minister, and then from there it goes to the, and what technical knowledge they have. So everything, this is one aspect. So everything is highly centralized in government because ministers have taken all the power on themselves. So there is no delegation. Without delegation, how are you going to perform? Now, one big problem, management of government budget. We are still having an outdated system of budget. You find every year there is a huge shortage of money. Surrender of money, including defense, which is so much short of money, some 8,000 to 10,000 crore every year of defense budget is surrendered. It cannot be used. Because one reason is, you see, it takes a lot of time to do procurement. You have to float tender, verify and things like that. We still have an annual budget. Most of the countries, Britain and every other country, has shifted to 3-year budgeting cycle. You see, this is one problem. Then in the March, they try to spend money, it goes waste. 50% of government budget, because financial year is up to March, is spent in the month of March. And there is no input, but there is only input budgeting. There is no output. Output budgeting means what results have you, if I allocate money for a particular activity, let's say public works, construction of a road, have you built the road? So money is its input budgeting. I'm not going to go in detail, there are complex issues. But just give you an So there is need for wide delegation of power. Now, this is Osborne and Gabler are very famous scholars. They have written a book in US. They say normal government budgets encourage managers to waste money. If they don't spend their entire budget by the end of fiscal year, three things happen. They lose the money they have saved, they get next year, and the budget director scolds them for requesting them too much. So UK has shifted to 3-year budgetary cycle. All unspent money is taken over to next year. They have gone in for outcome budgets. Budget is a contract for performance. They have changed the outlook. I give you money, you give me results. Then they have gone into other thing. Now, similar problem is purchase and contract management, because government generally, in practice, government buys most inferior products at the highest price. Because government systems are not designed to deliver high quality products. Float a tender. Every time float a tender and give it to the lowest. But you don't realize that a poor quality product will come, who will underbid and take. This is what's happening across the board. And there is a psychology that every government servant is corrupt, so hem him with rules. So you buy an inferior quality product. So So this is what the procurement system requires officials to buy for government in a way different than they would for themselves. And by checking their discretion, there is an animus which separates government officials from their normal faculties as a thinking human being. So this is a big problem. See, in government procurement system, and most of the scandals which you see, corruption scandals, are on account of purchasing big contracts. But is the answer to them hemmed with further rule? You see, further restricts the discretion of the government officer to buy best value product. That is. So this is what Deming, the famous management guru, you might have heard the name. Purchasing procedures that award orders on the basis of low prices will result in poor quality products. This is what he says. And this is one, you see, defense is always a big scandal, but this is one defense expert in US said, the nation's defense programs lose far more to inefficient procedures than to fraud or dishonesty. The truly costly problems are those of overcomplicated organization and rigid procedures, not avarice or connivance. So systems are not designed to work. So why it happens? Why it is all happen? So as just to say, Karl Marx, the ruling ideas of each age have ever been the ideas of the ruling class. That's what Karl, so why reforms are not coming? Why reforms are not coming? Or the best lack all the convictions, and the worst are filled with passionate intensity. This is, so why the reforms are not coming despite knowing the problem? The price good men pay for indifference to public affairs is to rule by evil men. That's why I say, please start taking interest in what happens inside government. So now I come to the other, what other countries have done and how to reform the system. So let me see. What we have is a Weberian model of bureaucracy. Have you heard of Max Weber?
Yes.
You all know that he was a German social scientist, and he was a great believer in bureaucracy. He said bureaucracy system is the best design to deliver things. Of course, he was writing experience of Bismarck's Germany, and he was writing in late 18th and early 19th century. So we are continuing, or even Britain was continuing, with the Weberian model of bureaucracy, which has certain characteristic. You see, suppression of office and incumbent, selection by merit, lifelong employment, promotion by seniority, fixed remuneration of grades, right of pension, and hierarchy. This is all what he said. But what is now, this model has become totally outdated in 21st century with computers, where space and time has shrunk. On a click of a button, you can reach the entire globe. You see, heaven high. So now a lot of thought has gone into, and the philosophy, the new philosophy, which other governments have adopted, which I'm going to change. For example, reinvent government. It's a book written by Osborne and Gelber. A lot of work was done in Great Britain about which I am going to come. They said, we need a catalytic government. We need a competitive-owned government. We need a competitive government. We need a mission-driven government, result-oriented government, customer-driven government, then earning rather than spending, anticipatory government, decentralized government, and market-driven government. This is a new philosophy which most of the governments are not now have embraced and to some extent largely is implemented. So first it started with Margaret Thatcher. Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan, they were two people who made a big, of course, they believe in market reform, but internally also the bureaucracy is similar in England was completely transformed as a result of Margaret Thatcher's initiative. Now, several initiatives were taken, and the most important was executive agencies. They said, give these people a lot of autonomy. They restructured government. Every department was created which had dealing with public. You see, into a public service, what is known as executive agency, with lot of autonomy in administrative, financial, and operational matters. So most of their departments, were restructured, and they completely transformed the and one of its main significant thing was of course they also introduced citizens charter. You might have heard of it. Have you heard of citizens charter? You see, this was introduced by John Major, then Tony Blair. It was a continuing thing. Reforming public service is fundamental to everything that labor today's Labor Party. One of its most significant feature was reforming of the higher, all top posts in Britain, made contractual, thrown open for competition, including private sector. Selection through public service commission. All top posts were thrown open. You have to apply, whether you are from private sector, you are from university, top post, and you have to apply, government of course, and then you have to go through public service commission. You have to sign a contract with government, say that this is, when I am appointed, 3 year or 5 year contract, this is what I am going to deliver. And then you were given lot of power. For example, in many of these service agencies, you don't have to go to public service commission for recruitment. Lot of autonomy. Your accountability was redesigned in terms of results you give. Results you give. You have to sign a memorandum of agreement with government. So this was defined, and you have created a autonomous structure like PSU. Let's say I worked in several PSU boards. My colleague would have worked. You see how BHEL is working, or Steel Plant Authority or ONGC works. Lot of autonomy, of course. Not to that extent, they are under the Companies Act, but lot of command. We have one example here of Indian Railways, which is work as a board which run by professionals with huge autonomy. That is, it is one of the most efficient organization in the country. It is run by professionals. It has a complete autonomy in its all operational matters. Of course, personnel, they are hamstrung by the, but they have given a huge autonomy. That's how. So, similar reform. Now, UK civil service, the most important thing they brought, and this is my burden of my main talk, there is no ethics code in central government today. We have a conduct rule. There is no ethics code. They brought out an ethics code, and which has made a statutory rule now, which there was a Nolan committee which brought out civil service ethics code, and that's their main thing is a public service. They have to observe integrity, honesty, objectivity, and impartiality. So these are the principles. Now, with ethics code, their philosophy is, if you have to maintain high ethical standards in public service. We have no ethics code in India. So high ethical standards in public, and I will give you complete autonomy to work, provided you have a, of course, they enforce similar ethics for ministers also. They have ethics code for minister, which they enforce. See, so ethics is very important. We want people at high positions at everywhere with high level of ethics. Value system has to be. They have created a value-based civil service. You see, in India it is other. It is not public service, it is self-service. You see, you call it public service, but it is self-service. So that is the whole problem. Now, US similarly had a Government Performance Results Act. Government Performance Results Act that promote focus on results, service quality, and public satisfaction. These are the three things. There is an act, and there was a national performance review which I mentioned, headed by Al Gore. They have implemented, and they came out decentralized personnel policy, streamlined budget and procurement system, and eliminate thousands of regulations which hamstring working. So US has also an Ethics in Government Act, mind it. This was brought out in following Nixon's Watergate scandal. They brought out an Ethics in Government Act, and under this, they have an Office of Government Ethics, 1989. They enforce ethics there. So US has done this. New Zealand, one of the most advanced countries on public service reform. For example, FRMB, you know, Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management Act. This was brought on the New Zealand pattern in India. You see, so New Zealand, same thing. Same thing with Singapore, introduced Canada, Australia, all Commonwealth countries have made a major reform of their public services. So what is the new management philosophy we should follow, which I am now coming? Decentralization of authorities and devolution of responsibility. Instead of Weberian model of bureaucracy, decentralize of authority and devolution of responsibility. Downsize the public services and privatize. Re-examine what government should pay for and do, what it should pay and not do, and what it should neither pay nor do. What government should pay and do, what it should pay and not do, and what it should neither pay nor do. Cost-effective way of delivering services, that means user charges. Customer orientation, including explicit quality standards. Benchmarking and measuring performance. Simplify regulations and reduce its cost. So, and also my main recommendation, create performance-based organizations. You see, for example, we have this successful cases like Operation Flood, Amul model, or even satellite launching in thing. They were all done under mission mode with lot of autonomy. So you have to restructure government. This is what Pradeep Khandelwala, he was director of IIM Ahmedabad. He has written a book on public service reform after a lot of research, and this is what he says. Agencification seems to represent the best hope for making the machinery of government in India efficient, economical, sensitive to citizens' needs and staff needs, clean, objective and agile. This it promises to basically by transforming bureaucratic management into professional, stakeholder sensitive, performance oriented management. Because when people who are top managers in private sector and come in government and see it's inside working, they're aghast. How should I, how can you deliver anything in this system? You may draw your salary and go home, but you can't deliver. You see, of course, I am not talking of army or the police. Most other public, they are different. They are different. Oh. So, as I said, there is a lot of autonomy has already been given. Wherever you give autonomy with a clear responsibility, things have been working. So this is in continuation. So what we need is, for India specific, make new civil service code and disciplinary regime so that dishonest are given quick punishment and summary punishment and honest are given protection. Our system is such that very often very honest officers get harassed, especially in the coal scam. Some very honest officer, just because CBI goes there and harasses them, Mr. Parikh was coal secretary, another Gupta they are having, they are known honest officers, but just because a handful of people and you put your signature on the file, naturally when you are working, see, they are being harassed. So our present system harasses honest officer. This is a disgrace. So dishonest are given put, make all senior appointments open to competition and to contract. Recruitment through UPSC and open to candidates outside the government. Now, in fact, under the policy, they have embraced today a free economy model, which means competition. Even present government, right from the time Manmohan Singh reform came and previous government, you are talking of competition of everyone, but not competition within the civil service. So once you are recruited, you are guaranteed promotion. How can it work? Then enforce accountability regime, bring performance contracting and make officials accountable for providing results. Downsize bureaucracy and improve productivity. Productivity is very low and work culture is very poor in government, if we experience. Then contract out services and deregulate and privatize. Streamline budgetary and financial management systems. Introduce outcome budgets in terms of delivering services. We have a budget expert sitting here. Redesign procurement systems to buy best value product. Create performance-based organizations. and inculcate high ethical values among civil servants, enact anything good. So this is practically my last point and one. So this is what say, you see, change and innovate. If you don't change, So this is just a, see, Dennis Waitley, Empires of the Mind, this is a book which Dr. Kalam used to recommend to read. You see, what worked yesterday won't work today. Yesterday, natural resources defined power. Today, knowledge is power. Why you should change? Why bureaucracy should change? It's colonial mode of working. 60 years or 70 years in the same. Yesterday, hierarchy was modeled. Today, synergy is mandate. Yesterday, leaders commanded and controlled. Today, leaders empower and coach. Yesterday, managers directed. Today, managers delegate. So, Darwin's, I am quoting, it is not the strongest species that survive, nor the most intelligent, but the most responsible for change. So we have to change. There is no change in the system. We have got books, our codes written in pre-colonial time. So, but the survive, nor most intelligent, but the most responsive to change. So this is the final point. And time, how to create an idea for change, which I expect from university don sitting here, students and all that, that create that change. I don't think we have reached that age of what Victor Hugo said, there is nothing more powerful than an idea whose time has come. I don't know whether its time has come. Time has come. Time has come that it is public services running has to improve. And why I am talking about it after 40 years or 50 years working in government, but I still have faith in the genius of Indian people to bring about this change. As Tagore said, Rabindranath Tagore, faith is the bird that feels the light and sings when the dawn is still dark. So it's still dark, but hope. So one has to have faith. So faith is the bird that feels the light and sings when the dawn is still dark. So thank you very much for giving me.
Specialization in law, governance, and policy, and my master's in development. So my question would be regard to the centralized form of recruitment process which you have just mentioned, and with the multiple rules that are guiding them in their appointment. So in this context, I would like to take the example of the State Public Service Commission recruitment, where Article 316 does not specify a very concrete rules for the appointment of the members. And not the appointment is very centralized. It's done mainly by the chief minister and the cabinet of members. But still there are a lot of incidences of corruption where the member is appointed. In many cases, it has been come to the notice that there was a money game that has happened. So do you think that in the absence of rules, which is specifically mentions about the recruitment is also a good idea where corruption can take another level which could harm the bureaucracy and the state capacity to in a different manner?
No, it's a very good question. What you are saying is only with reference to Public Service Commission members?
Yes, sir. The Article 316,
that's a very serious problem. because in, when the constitution was made, when the constitution was made in 1950, they never thought that political leadership will come to this stage that without following any rules, they will have political appointees in the commission. But fortunately, it is not happening in the Union Public Service Commission. At least they are appointing. UPSC have people. Because if people lose faith in the institution, then it would be, I mean, very difficult. So Public Service Commission, there is a serious problem there, and best would be to have a rule, to have a law, another law, to regulate the qualification, and a commission or committee to set up to select members of the committee. It has to be a transparent system. And this can come only through public noise, through public noise and all that. Would you like to add something on this subject? So that point is well taken, that the State Public Service Commission today, the quality of members who are appointed is very poor and people are losing faith. In fact, other day Yogi Adityanath, when he came, he called the chairman of UP Public Service Commission, and openly it came in the TV and said, why are you all, your appointees are all Yadavs? It has come to that. We can't afford that kind of thing. We have to fight it.
So, according to you, if there needs to be a change in that article, so is public noise enough, or there should be some judicial intervention or a constitutional?
No. You see, the point is, a constitution article need not be changed. You can always make rules.
All right.
No need to change. Articles are okay. Article is okay because there should be a high-powered commission, independent commission, and their independence is guaranteed. That is okay, but government should always frame a rule that recruitment will be through a proper, open, transparent system, and there will be some qualification for appointment. It can be done without changing the constitution.
So you don't advocate for any constitutional amendment?
There is no need. It's already there. That's there. There is no need.
Okay.
Within the constitution, you can frame a rule.
All right. Because
take the power out of politicians' hands. You see, he has usurped some power in his hand and acting in an arbitrary manner.
Okay.
That's not the intention of the constitution.
Because a lot of high court cases had always upheld this, several cases in this context, and have directed the government to take steps. But still now we haven't seen much state government to act on it. Maybe Punjab Commission has brought few reforms, but it was very person specific. It was not a very process specific process.
Yeah. Yeah, so actually the whole philosophy, I am personally against that a chief minister should select a university vice chancellor. It should be given to the university senate or somebody. Why should chief minister, for example, should have exclusive power to select a commission of public service? It should be through a process. For example, when you are appointed through IES examination as a young probationer, there also the orders are issued by the President of India. That is in name. But without Public Service Commission going through, can the President of India, whatever it is, appoint somebody out as a young IAS officer? He can't. It's a question of convention and thing. Why should Chief Minister have exclusive power to appoint a Public Service Commission member? You see, this was never anticipated by our constitution makers. There should be a commission, there should be laid down rules, we should select a member of the public commission, a very high post, transparent procedure, we should enjoy public confidence.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your answer.
Somebody here, they are here.
Hi, sir. Hello. So I have two questions. So one is about decentralization and devolution of powers. So actually, we are in a system like currently we are spending huge amount of money on buying votes, freebies, etc., etc. So we have a on the other hand inefficient bureaucratic system. So I have a chat with a lot of public administration experts at the university and outside. So the scholars was response to my question was that so we are buying votes, so better to have a good IAS officer rather than good sarpanch. So we are, as a bureaucracy, bureaucratic system, they are not believing in the electoral system. Our electoral system is missing. So that's one response, and what's your views on that? And second one is about, if you look at the third tier governments, so the basically, if you look at the kind of words they used in the 73rd and 74th amendments, it's like more than US constitution. It's like 4,000 total is around 8,000 words. So what panchayati does is decided by the state or central government, state government per se. So if you look at the functions like 73rd, there are 29 functions allocated to the 73rd, 16 functions allocated to the 74th. So unless, if we have powers, but unless we are not giving financial autonomy to the panchayats or urban local bodies, I don't think it's going to not going to serve the purpose. So could you like to comment on this?
Let me understand, your question is that panchayats and all that should be given more autonomy? Is that the question, na? Your question is the panchayats should be given more autonomy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. They should be given more autonomy, especially financial autonomy. So without autonomy, how will they deliver? So they should be given, power should be delegated. In fact, even our present district administration system itself is a legacy of colonial time. One very top ICS officer who was cabinet secretary, Nirmal Mukherjee, has suggested that district itself should be abolished. Collector's post should be abolished, and it should be given to this Zilla Parshad, what you are saying, and others. Because that whole thing, context has changed. So to that extent, I agree with you. That our, at every level, we need to delegate powers. We need to delegate powers. For example, you see the situation in of our roads. I don't know here, but everywhere there are potholes, chaotic situation. Now if you, power, execution job is with executive engineer, but power to award the contract is with the superintending engineer. The chief engineer is responsible for an irrigation project, but government goes to government and to the secretary, to ministry or other level. Give full powers. That is what is the philosophy of public. Give full powers to him, down the line, the man, and then ask him to deliver results. So that is the thing. So it has to be at various level delegation within the government for able to perform. So I agree with you.
Hello. Good afternoon, sir. My name is Akshay, and I am a student of MA Development. So I have two questions. If I'll just try to summarize it. In one of the slides that you had given, you had mentioned an approach to new public management to make to enable government to select only certain functions that they need to perform. Huh. And the ones they don't need to perform, they can privatize it.
Right.
Now the issue with privatization is, if you outsource this, I understood it as outsourcing. Yeah. If you outsource it to someone, the question of accountability comes in. So if something happens, if a certain public service is outsourced, who's accountable for if that public service does not function anymore? Because government has outsourced it, government can't take the blame, neither can the private player. So there's a conflict of interest there with respect to market coming into play.
No. The point is, when you outsource, you have a contract that he has to deliver a specified level of services.
Mm.
Let's take the Airport Authority of India. They were earlier doing the cleaning job themselves or the security jobs themselves. So they have outsourced the security job. Many government departments have now outsourced the security job or the cleaning job.
They are not doing themselves. They are paying for it, but they ensure that somebody is inspecting every day that that the cleaning is done properly or security is maintained. So in terms of the contract which you do, you have to ensure some performance parameters, and then you have to inspect them and see that it is implemented.
Okay.
That is the idea.
But aren't those functions, shouldn't they be performed by government themselves rather than outsourcing it
to
private?
Yeah, but there are many functions because government resources are limited. It should concentrate on core function.
And what are the core functions?
Core function, for example, you had earlier when we were, during Pandit Nehru's time, we opened hotels in public sector. Ashoka Hotel in Delhi. When the conference was taking place, there were no private sector hotels. Today things have changed. Dispose of those hotels. Like India Tourism Development Corporation or this Karnataka Tourism Corporation, they are doing so many functions. Today country has developed, we don't have to do these functions. Government should concentrate on its core functions. Core functions, not do these things, and their energy should not be wasted. So that is the whole time, because you have limited resources. You should not do things which you can be done properly by private sector. That is the whole idea.
Hello, sir. My question is, there was a few years back a central public service, right to public service act proposed, which is still pending. But in the same line, there are many states which have enacted right to public services act. Do you think for the public service system to work more efficiently, is it necessary that we pass such laws which will penalize and point out the exact person who is responsible in the system for which the public service system is not working will be more efficient?
Yeah, few cases it can be. Few cases it can be. For example, what Britain they had done is they have a citizen's charter. Now, citizen charter, they write passport agency. They write if you apply for a passport, within 1 week, we will issue the passport and deliver at your house. I apply for a driving license. It will be issued to you in 3 days and delivered. That is what Britain has done. Now, in India, since our bureaucracy, they have made it into a kind of something like birth certificates or death certificates. These are the normal functions because Madhya Pradesh has done, some other states have done. But surely a citizen has a right to get his services. Like if you have a passport or driving license, every day you have there, he has a right. Now, how government does it has to decide. Now, a public servant, yes, he should be penalized if he is not doing, like Right to Information Act, today there is a penalty. If you are not supplying an information in time, there is a penalty. So there should be some method, some coercing action when a public servant, which is his duty to do, simple jobs, he is not doing, he should be penalized for that. Is that all right? But you can't make it complicated thing like a big contracting or execution of an irrigation project or a supply of power, you can't introduce these things. You have to make the whole system efficient. You see, you can't just say, I have putting up a mega power plant producing 500 megawatt of electricity, and then you say, look, I will penalize people. There are so many agencies involved. If you don't deliver, you can't do that. You have to make the system efficient.
Sir, so, I wanted to ask you the question on the contractual, the appointment of the bureaucrats through the contractual process. So, if we understand it, in the labor laws, there are already debates about, how this contractual, form of employment is also very, it creates a lot of mess. So don't you think if this form of appointment is going to happen in India, so I just want to know what is your explanation on the contractual appointment that you were mentioning?
No, this is something different. Here it is only for top bureaucracy. And that too, you don't lose your job, you don't get high, senior post. That is what I understand Britain is, only for top post. Suppose you are managing director of or you are a secretary to government. For that post, a process of selection is there, independent selection is there through Public Service Commission. That's what it is. That is no parallel with those labor contractual. This is a different thing. You will remain a permanent civil servant, but you can't get those higher posts unless you prove your efficiency. That's what it is. There is no comparison.
Department was asked to prepare citizen charter. Every agency prepared the citizen charter. But nothing happened. It didn't really work. The Public Affairs Foundation, Public Affairs Center in Bangalore did a very interesting study. In fact, I was associated with that. I was the sort of project officer for that. We did a study across India, state and central government, how effectively it worked. And we brought out very interesting points. We found that it was totally ineffective in the absence of any preparation, any foundation, training, and involvement of the public in a scheme which was intended to benefit public. So basically, if we just hear about a reform, and then we start on it without adequate preparation, which defeats the purpose. The second thing which Dr. Mathur mentioned to us about output budget. The budgeting system, as we appreciate, as we have in India, is input budgeting system. Actually, the system is, as NV says, the whole budgeting system is a very elaborate process. We were all part of it while working in the ministry. But suddenly, Government of India got an idea that we should have output budgeting system. And they introduced it about 8 to 9 years ago, something like that. Each ministry, each department was asked to identify what output will be generated by spending the money. Now, every department started preparing an output budget. Earlier, before that, there was something called performance budgeting system, which was introduced. We have tried out so many things without really our heart getting into it. We tried, the Government of India tried with the zero-based budgeting system. Somebody heard about it and decided to introduce it. It's a good system which is doing extremely well in the United States. We copied it. It was a failure. We then started with performance budgeting system. Every department used to prepare a performance budget, which was presented along with the budget papers to the parliament and in the state government, indicating what were the targets or goals fixed for each project or activity, how much was achieved, including for public sector, and what was the shortfall, what was the reason. And every department used to publish it. And it became a very routine thing, with only instead of being a whole, the all-around exercise, performance budgeting was prepared just before the budget was prepared by each ministry. In a main idea was to prepare a document and submit it, get away with it. When we started the output budgeting system, it's a very good system if you really implement it. Because money is an input into an activity or a program. And then it was, you spend the Ministry of Finance or the Planning Commission at that time, now it has been changed, allocate the money for a program or a project, and then what do we get out of it? What is produced? So an object of output, what is expected of the spending the money, it is to be prepared by each ministry. And then the next year, it is to be reviewed along with how much was achieved. If you go into the documents of some of these ministries, some of the ministries on output budget, it will be laughable. For instance, they will say that we decide to have so many meetings. You know, most of these activities are like this. Government, you will find saying that we would like to have this so many meetings conducted, or we will say that so many sort of, the ideal thing will be, say, for instance, a training program like this. Now, a training program, we decide, okay, how many students will be sort of trained, or what is the output? What is the cost involved in training a person? All this sort of, you work it out and make it an elaborate process. Instead of it, you will find that everywhere, outputs are just indicated, whatever comes to mind, in a routine way, and is never reviewed, never really used this as a tool for management. So it became ultimately a failure. So what I want to say, just to add to that, is that the government is so wide, so spread out, and the government has, there is really no ownership. What happens is, even if a person starts a project, you know, he has a limited term, he is there for some time, and then he just leaves it out. One of the exceptions will be the efforts which Mr. Sheshan started for improving the electoral process. He did his heart and soul into it. He bulldozed his way into it, and then it somehow is continuing, partly because there is the fourth estate, the press has played a major role into it. The media awareness, the people's expectation has grown up. But it rarely happens in the government. We take up a project, a reform activity, try it out and apply it half-heartedly, and then it fails. So that's one thing which I wanted to highlight with these two examples. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. And to some of my students from MA Development, it has been exactly a month. 10th March, Indian Parliament did not see much debate on the state of environmental governance in India. But CAG of India report that was signed in December 2016 was actually making its way into public document, because once it gets tabled in Parliament, it's available for public readership. And it has been a month. If you check the media, how many news stories have been written on this is anyone's guess. Around 10 news clips you will come around. That was when I looked at it last. I was speaking about this report to my students in this week's class. And every chapter you read, you would start asking a question that when we were in schools and colleges, there was another name called Khernar. Because the audit report says environment clearance conditions are violated, there's no compliance. Even the compliance monitoring institutions that were supposed to monitor compliance has not performed their role. And there is no demolition that ever happens. There's no Khernar around. And that seems to be the question. And when I told my students when I was reading this, the question that came to my mind is, where is Khernar? They didn't know who is Khernar. Who was he? What did he do? Why is Sir using his name as a metaphor? People called Khernar a demolition guy. He will go around, and if he finds violation, there will be demolitions that will exactly follow. So we need to have the memory about public bureaucrats when we teach and when we study public policy. It's not merely theory. We need to remember P.S. Appu. If you look at EPW archives, you will see that in Indian public services, there have been very public-spirited, very much principled bureaucrats who have served Indian public services, and there have been books written about the steel frame, which still gets referred to as steel frame, but steel frame is steel frame because there have been some people who put their principles before the privileges. I think it's time to thank all of you, and once again thank Dr. Mathur, Sethu Madhavan, Thanks, Prasad. Thanks, Giridhar. Thanks, all the students.